Jesus that is revealed, the more opposition begins to grow against him. Is that the religious establishment in particular, but maybe even today we're going to read maybe a little more surprising fashion who is against Jesus. So as we look to Mark's gospel, we're going to read the first six verses of the sixth chapter. If you saw in your bulletin, I've given the title today a phrase that you've likely heard. Familiarity breeds contempt. And I'm going to say that as little as possible. For some reason, I cannot say the word familiarity very well. But you've heard that expression. If you haven't, it means something like this. It goes back to what I was sharing with the children is sometimes if you know something too well, you just cease to see the extraordinary nature of something. We're too close to it. In fact, it's an old, old proverb. If you look into it, it appears as early, maybe even earlier, in Chaucer's work from the 1300s. It's found in a tale that that was written then. It may be even older than that. A dictionary would say something like this. It means that knowing someone too well makes you overlook the good things about that person and to be more aware of their faults, leading to bad feelings or even scorn. Familiarity can lead to those kinds of things. Likely, we're going to read here, some of that is there were people who knew Jesus very well. Jesus was a real person. He was born, yes, in an extraordinary way to the Virgin Mary, but he was raised in a small town of Nazareth to a carpenter and became a carpenter himself before his public ministry. Some 30 years or so, he lived in relative anonymity, even in his own town, about who he really was. And we're going to find out even to his own family as to the real nature of who exactly Jesus was and why God's Son would come to this earth in this way. It was revealed to his mother and his father and some other people near his birth, but that didn't translate into everyone accepting all those things about Jesus and probably even knowing those things. And you can imagine, I don't want to be disrespectful to the scriptures, but it's always dangerous to say, well, you can imagine, but we're not told almost anything of Jesus' childhood. One episode about when he was traveling with his parents and they found him in the temple. But it's likely that as an adult, there were people who had literally known Jesus his whole life and just couldn't imagine that this person that they grew up with could be anything extraordinary. We may all suffer from that. I've told the story often about being in my hometown and seeing somebody running for district attorney and asking my brother, who's lived there for many years now, so-and-so, I don't want to say his name. He might be one of the three people that listen to this sermon on the internet. But he's running for district attorney. I was like, he's running for district attorney? And I'm thinking I knew him as a teenager. And probably, unfortunately, he knew me as a teenager. But I was like, what in the world is he doing running for district attorney? He said, well, not only is he running for district attorney, he's running for re-election. And he's done a really good job. See, for me, familiarity bred contempt in that. I was assuming he was the same guy he was at 17 or 18 years old. Thank the Lord, most of us are not that same person. Well, in Jesus' life, could it be that same thing? Now, there was nothing bad to look back on in Jesus' childhood. I believe he was the sinless Savior from birth, but there are some people who go, you know, I don't know what it is now, but I know back in middle school he couldn't hit a curveball, or I know, you know, he was nothing extraordinary. I'm like, he made the rocking chair on my front porch. That's all I know about him. Or people would say, look, I know his family. His sister, she's really extraordinary, but Jesus has always seemed fairly ordinary to me. See, familiarity can breed that kind of contempt and even scorn. And so we're going to read in these few verses today, it wasn't just that people wondered if Jesus could be extraordinary. They were sure that he was not. So let's read these verses in Mark's gospel. Hear the word of the Lord for us today. He went away from there and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. And on the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished, saying, "Where did this man get these things? What is the wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us?" And listen to this. And they took offense at him. And Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his hometown and among his relatives and in his own household. And he could do no mighty works there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them." And he, meaning Jesus, marveled because of their unbelief. And he went about among the villages teaching. It's a remarkable story about Jesus. And really, I want to show you three things in these short verses. I want you to see the scorn of the crowd, that the way they treat Jesus, the questions that they ask were not really questions. They were meant to denigrate and put down Jesus. The scandal of the Christ. Mark's gospel is in telling us that Jesus is just not some miracle worker, some good teacher. He is the Lord of the universe. If you remember a few weeks back, that trilemma of C.S. Lewis. He's either Lord, liar, or lunatic. Mark's gospel says he is definitely the Lord. And so there's a scandal that comes upon those who hear the claims of Christ to say, "I've got to choose, and I must choose, but common sense tells me what I must choose, and it's not Lord." And then finally, the sadness of the curse of why Jesus doesn't or can't do these miracles in his own hometown. So let's start with the scorn of the crowd. If you notice there, it said that the crowd was astonished with Jesus, and then immediately they began to ask these questions, and I think they're meant to be rhetorical questions. I think they're meant to be disparaging questions, and they question really who Jesus is and what he has done. They do it in the reverse order. The first three questions are kind of, how's he doing all these things, this Jesus that we all know? They ask, where did this man, you know, in our day and time, you can't say things like "this man" or "these people." I think it's meant in that kind of derogatory sense. Where did this man get these things? In other words, how is this guy we know doing all these things? Secondly, what is the wisdom given to him? He's nothing special. How is it now that we hear this teaching that sounds so wise to some? And then thirdly, about what he's done, the power and the work of Jesus. How are such mighty works done by his hands? I don't think that inflection is undue there. I think it's the way it's being asked. What is this guy doing or being able to do all these things? Then they start questioning who he is. Jesus is beginning now to make claims that he is the Messiah, the one that God has sent. And so they ask, is this not the carpenter? We know him. His shop's right down the road. I got a chair, a table, a desk, whatever. He's a carpenter. He's no miracle worker. He's no rabbi. He's no teacher. In fact, they ask, isn't he not the son of Mary and the brother of these? And list four of Jesus' brothers. And then they ask, and are not his sisters here too? Lots of people point out the fact that they say he's the son of Mary would be a way to kind of throw stones at Jesus. A person in Jesus' day would always be called by their father's name. But we know Jesus' father was Joseph, and yet Mary was with child before she was with Joseph. So this may be a not so backhanded way of reminding Jesus of his past, or at least what they thought was his past. You see, these people can't reconcile what he taught and what he had done with who they thought he was. They thought he was Jesus, the boy down the street, Jesus, the teenager that we grew up with, Jesus, the young man who's a carpenter, maybe a good carpenter, but just a carpenter, they would say. Here's what we know His hometown got it wrong. His relatives, at least for a time, got it wrong. The religious leaders certainly got it wrong. Rome, the empire, got it wrong. Here's the reality, and still today, many people get it wrong. For some of the same reasons, because Jesus, his name, the name that's above all names, the name that's on the year of our Lord, 2020, for 2020 years we've been referring to Jesus in our dates, it's just too familiar. He's just someone who's out there, someone that can be mixed in with all the other historical figures. Maybe he's extraordinary. Maybe he's rememberable. Memorable, I guess, is the word I'm looking for there. But he's nothing special. He's certainly not anything out of this world, we might say. And that's always been the case. In fact, just in the history of our own country, you can go back to the very early days of the United States of America. You know the name Thomas Jefferson, right? He's famous for lots of things. One of the things he's very well known for is publishing this book. In fact, you can buy it on Amazon today, a printed version of this. It's called The Life and Morals of Jesus of Nazareth. But what this book is, in fact, here's the actual book. It's on display at the Smithsonian. Thomas Jefferson in 1820, this was after his public office days, 6 years before his death, he produced this. It's only 84 pages, and it is his version of the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And what Jefferson did is he went through the Gospels and he eliminated everything concerning miracles in the Gospels. Well, if you've read the Gospels, you take out a lot. That's why he was able to get it in 84 pages. And oh, by the way, 84 pages of four columns. One was in Greek, one was in Latin, one was in French, and one was in English. So it's not very long, really, just that English portion. And so his gospel ends like this. This is the very last verse in Thomas Jefferson's gospel. There they laid Jesus and rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulcher and departed. That's the end for Thomas Jefferson. You see, Jefferson, who, brilliant man, no less. I mean, how many of us are running around writing things in Greek, Latin, French, and English, and yet his mind couldn't conceive of the eternal Son of God taking on human flesh, living a perfect life, and dying as a perfect sacrifice for the sins of many. And so, what was written about this gospel was this, is that in 1813, a letter to John Adams, Thomas Jefferson wrote this, that this book, this gospel that he wrote contains the most sublime and benevolent code of morals which has ever been offered to man. You see, when Thomas Jefferson looked back on the life of Jesus, all he thought was, here's a man that taught us how to be a good person in this world. And if your version of Jesus ends with him still in the tomb, then the later New Testament tells us that we're still in our sins and we're without hope and we're without eternal life. You see, Thomas Jefferson couldn't come to the fact that Jesus was what he claimed to be in those gospels. So he literally, and you can see on this paper, he took a penknife to a Bible and he began to cut out all the portions that he could get on board with and he glued them into his own gospel. Everything else went in the garbage. You see, Thomas Jefferson, I think, was guilty of familiarity breeding contempt. That all he could conceive of was a man who had lived, and men don't do miracles. Men don't rise from the dead. Men don't rule over the universe. Men weren't there at the creation, and every knee doesn't bow to any man. See, Thomas Jefferson couldn't get on board with the claims that Jesus himself made and his followers with him. So Thomas Jefferson would offer up with these crowds of people from Jesus' own hometown, scorn is all they could have for the Savior in Jesus Christ. So to go along with that scorn, I can't possibly conceive of someone who could be all that Jesus claimed to be. There was this scandal about Jesus' claim. Jesus clearly believed that he was the Messiah that had been promised for centuries upon centuries to God's people. Verse 3 told us that they took offense at Jesus. So it was more than, I'm not sure about that. It was, how dare you make those kinds of claims. In fact, this word offense, scandal is not a word I came up with. The Greek word for offense is scandalizomai. You hear that word scandal in there. The Bible uses it in several places to say these people were literally scandalized by the claims that Jesus had. What he claimed to be and what he claimed to have done couldn't possibly be. And so they rejected him because of that scandal in them. He's in his hometown. And so he says, this isn't a quote from the Old Testament. It's a saying apparently that was well known. A prophet is not without honor except in his, or a prophet is not without honor except in his hometown. In other words, you can be well thought of almost anywhere, but not in your own hometown. Actually, what he's doing is making a claim about himself and his mission. In fact, here's what I think he's saying. Well, of course, they reject me and deny me and despise me because that's what people have always done to the prophets who've been sent from God. If you've been in our midweek study on Wednesday mornings, we've been studying the book of Acts. We looked at that just this week, that part of the teaching that was done there, Stephen, the first martyr who was stoned to death by these same religious establishment kind of people, said that people will destroy those things that they can't get on board with, the things that they can't understand, and it's always been like that. The most religious people, even in Old Testament days, did away with the people who brought the truth of God's word. And so Jesus is now claiming, I'm here, I'm bringing you the truth of God, I am the truth of God. And he says, you seek to destroy me because of that. Isn't that what the scriptures tell us to expect, Jesus says. And it is. If we went back even just to one familiar passage, we hear it sometimes around Easter, but Isaiah 53, the suffering servant passages in the Old Testament and Isaiah's prophecy is saying, this is what the Messiah is going to look like. And it says this in verse 3 of Isaiah 53. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering, familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Jesus says, I'm the servant sent to suffer on your behalf, but I know you will hold me in low esteem because I'm not what you thought I would be. And there's a point of warning, I think, for us. This is a little bit what I was getting at with the children's sermon this morning, is that being close to the teaching and the work of Christ does not equate automatically to faith and salvation. Jesus demands of us repentance and faith and just being close to the things of God. Many of you are like me. I don't remember a time in my life where I didn't know something about Jesus. And I am so thankful for that. I'm thankful that God blessed me to be born into a family that honored the name of Jesus. But I'm 100% sure there was a period in my life where I took that for granted, that I knew something about Jesus without actually knowing Jesus. And I knew that people were supposed to bow their knee to Jesus, but I wasn't actually doing that. In fact, I think there was a time in my life where I could explain what salvation was, and yet I was not living in light of it. I think Jesus' hometown exemplifies that for us. And it could be worse. There was another time when Jesus was in his own hometown, and they reacted even more harshly to him, violently towards him. Luke chapter 4 tells us that Jesus was standing in the synagogue in his hometown, the synagogue where his family would have attended worship, and he was reading a passage, a prophecy in Isaiah's book from the 61st chapter, the first and second verses. And when he had finished reading, he looked at all of his friends and neighbors and the people that had helped raise him. And he said, today, this scripture is being fulfilled for you. He was making a claim that Isaiah wrote about him. And it says that the crowd was outraged. He was making a specific claim that rejecting him was rejecting God. And Luke chapter 4 says, all the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him off the cliff. Now it goes on to tell us he was miraculously saved from that. He just walked through the crowd untouched. But why did they react so violently? Because the suffering servant, when he came, Isaiah had already told us he would be despised and rejected. And so we find that true of Jesus. The scandal of the Christ is this. You can be scornful or mocking of Jesus, and many are in the world we live in today. Or you can even try to do the proverbial throwing him off the cliff. You can try to do away with Jesus, but rejection is rejection. Whether it's in a small way or a large way, to reject Christ is to reject God's Son, the Savior. The scandal of the cross is that Jesus was these things, the virgin-born, divine, eternal Son of God who lived a perfect life so that he could die as our perfect sacrifice and give eternal salvation to his people by faith in him and only him. In fact, Acts chapter 4 tells us that salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. That was Jesus' claim. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And that didn't change. Even after Jesus' day, Paul, the apostle, says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, he says, we preach Christ crucified. We preach that the Messiah came and died so that we might have life. That's not the way people thought it would happen. Familiarity breeds contempt. They knew all the scriptures and thought everybody agreed how it was going to happen, that a king would come and lead an army and they would overthrow the world. And so when the suffering servant came and bled and suffered and died, there was nothing but scorn and contempt. But Paul says, we preach Christ crucified. And he says, this is what resulted from it. It was a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles. Guess what that word stumbling block is in Greek? It's scandalon. There's that same root word again. It was scandalous that God's own Son would come and even live among dirty old people like us, but he certainly wouldn't die for people like us. So it was a stumbling block. It caused people to stumble. And to others, it was just sheer foolishness. So finally, if we've looked at the scorn that the crowd had for him, the scandal of who Jesus was as the Christ, what is this sadness of the curse? Again, verse 5 and 6 said, and he could do no mighty works there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And then it says this, and he marveled or was amazed, your version might say, because of their unbelief. Do you know only two times in the whole entire Bible does it say Jesus was amazed? Once, it was a Roman centurion. This unconverted Gentile came and had such great faith that Jesus could do a miracle without actually going to his house. It says Jesus was amazed at his faith. The second time is right here in Mark chapter 6. He's amazed at their unbelief. Twice Jesus is amazed. Once at faith, once at no faith, once at belief, secondly at unbelief. So why does it say that Jesus could do no mighty works there? In fact, in Matthew's gospel, this story, it's softened a little bit. It says that Jesus did no works there. I don't think Mark intends for us to believe that Jesus was unable, that Jesus was powerless to do those. In fact, he says he didn't do anything except heal a few sick people, as if that's no big deal. But why does it say that he couldn't do that there? Well, here's why I've called this the sadness of the curse. These people lived, and you and I live in a world under a curse, going all the way back to Adam and Eve. that we live under the guilt and the power of sin, is that every human being that's ever been born stands before a holy God and can make no claim to holiness ourselves. We have not kept God's standard for how we are to live as subjects to the King. And living in that, we needed something to break that guilt, to pay the price for our guilt, but also to free us from the power of sin. In God's eternal plan, it was to give His only Son in order that we might be out from under the curse of sin and death and live in newness of life. It's why Jesus died, and it's why He was raised from the dead, to pay for our sins and to give us new life. And so, when Jesus came, it ushered in the kingdom of God. The last days were beginning to take place, that we look now for the second coming of Jesus Christ. And in that time, as the kingdom of God comes, it was accompanied by signs and wonders. It's why we read so often in the New Testament, Jesus did all these things. The apostles and the disciples and even some of Jesus' followers were able to do these things. These were Old Testament promises that when the Messiah comes, there will be signs and wonders, miracles would take place. Well, in Jesus' own hometown, there was such unbelief, such a rejection of who Jesus was, that Jesus did not want to give the sign of blessing in a place where it would not be present. You see, the coming of the kingdom of God reverses that curse. The people of faith experience both power and blessing from God, but when we reject Christ, it's a rejection of God's favor and blessing. So Jesus didn't want to give them a sign of the kingdom of God where it was not being ushered in among them. And He would preach the way to experience that would be repentance, and it would be faith. I'll close with this. One commentator, Kent Hughes, says this: unbelief robs the church of its power. Now you might say, unbelief isn't a characteristic of the church, but I suspect you know like I know, there's lots of unbelief amongst the gathered people of God at times. Even those who are very familiar, those of us who have heard of Jesus, known of what Jesus did and what He taught for all of our lives, sometimes still can reject the truth of His word. Hughes goes on to say this: we can add new programs until we don't have enough hours in the day, or we can add programs where there's not even enough paper to advertise them in our bulletins, but without a believing expectancy in Christ and His power, nothing will come of it. You see, we can spin our wheels and do all kinds of things, but if we haven't come to grips of the claims of Jesus Christ Himself, Hebrews put it this way: without faith, it's impossible to please God. First and foremost, we have to know what Jesus claimed, that He was the eternal God and salvation only comes through Him. And we can't be desensitized to that. And we read what Jesus did and what He taught. He really did those things and He really taught those things. That in Mark's gospel, we've already seen Jesus actually stood in a boat and calmed the storm to say, I'm greater than all the universe around us. He healed a diseased woman who had suffered for more than a decade. And He'd say, I'm more than your brokenness and your failings in your own health. He raised a little girl from the dead and He said, I have the very gift of life in my hands. Those were the claims that Jesus made because He wants you and I to know that He is the Son of God, the Savior of sinners. We're going to close and sing, I Surrender All. I hope that that's your cry of faith today. Either for the first time or again and again, we claim that if Jesus is who He says He is, and He is, then we must give ourselves fully to Him. We don't have to wonder, who is this man who can do such things? How does he teach such things? The Bible tells us He is God's own Son, the Messiah, the Savior, your Savior. So I pray that as we sing, we would really surrender ourselves fully and finally to the Christ Jesus. Let me pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank You for Your word. We thank You that from the very beginning, even while Adam and Eve were still in the Garden of Eden, you promised us a Savior in Jesus Christ. And so throughout many, many centuries, we've seen you at work among your people, that you've saved us in all kinds of ways here on earth, but we look ultimately to salvation for our eternal life. We thank you that you've made it clear in your word that Jesus is the Savior of sinners, that he didn't come to this earth to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. I pray that we'd surrender ourselves in faith today. We would repent of all ideas that we could save ourselves or be good enough for you, and that we would fall at the foot of the cross and we would look to Jesus as our Savior. We live in a world where he may be despised and rejected and scorned, but we know he loves us and he came to save us from our sins. And so we exalt him with the name that is above all names. I pray that we would see the day when every knee would bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. We'll give you glory and praise and honor for that. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.